Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me, Jay and Wolfram. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present some of our recent data. When I was asked 2 years ago, I had this title, I would like to add with reduced and preserved ejection fraction, because we believe that HDACs are central in both entities, but in different ways, and I will try to convince you of that today. These are my disclosures. Our lab is interested in histone deacetylases, HDACs. There are many HDACs, class 1, class 2A, class 2B, zinc-dependent enzymes, NAD-dependent enzymes, class 3, class 4. What we found, and Eric Olson found, Tim McKinsey found, and many labs found, that our class 2A HDACs are highly signal responsive. And that really attracted me very early on. And so I focused on studying the signal responsiveness of these HDACs. And among them, HDAC 4, can you see my mouse? Ah, yeah. HDAC 4 emerged really as one agent with a remarkable selective responsiveness to beta adrenergic signaling. So it was great to listen to Howard Rockman, because this was also one of the reasons why we were so attracted to study in HDAC 4. So I start with this. So HDAC 4 is remarkable signal responsive. I will try to show you the key features that we try to target HDAC 4 as a therapeutic target. I start with the take-home message. Actually, there are two take-home messages. What we learned, the non-enzymatic domain, the N-terminal half, is actually protecting from heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And what we learned very recently, and that is all unpublished, that the enzymatic domain is actually inducing heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And for all these, for both, we are developing therapeutic strategies. And that is also the structure of the talk. In the first talk, I will talk about the gene therapy approach, targeting or using the non-enzymatic domain. Also a new protein-protein interaction inhibitor approach, a small molecule-based approach. And this is new, an enzymatic inhibitor that is useful in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Very, very shortly, I want to show you three features of HDAC 4 that help HDAC 4 to increase its non-enzymatic function in the nucleus to inhibit the transcription factor MEF2. One thing that is necessary, it needs to be glycosylated, O-gluconeculated at serine 642, because this is an event that makes it sensitive to a protease. Actually, this protease is called ABHG5. It's a lipid droplet associated protein. It's activated by pKa, by beta adrenergic stimulation. And that results in proteolysis of this N-terminal fragment that inhibits MEF2 clearly without an enzymatic function, because it lacks the enzymatic domain. We found that HDAC4NT is reduced in chronic models of heart failure. This is pressure overload, TAC surgery. You see that HDAC4NT levels are actually reduced. We restored HDAC4NT with an AAV9-based gene therapy approach with Oliver Müller. And here you see in the TAC model that this is a drop of ejection fraction in mice without HDAC4NT overexpression, and with the restored expression, we can slow down the development of heart failure. Recently, we also had another proof of concept experiment. This was after ischemia reperfusion. Here you see that this is a preventive approach. When you give HDAC4NT before, you can actually improve post-infarct heart failure. We have a couple of proof of concept experiments now, the two that I'm showing, but also we tested that in the conditions of diabetes and heart failure in a very severe form. We also in a very rare disease, neutral lipid storage disease, it is effective, also in Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, in a mouse model for Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. This patent was granted, and we are now moving to pig models to test whether this can be also further translated to clinical application. This is the mechanism, and I just do it on this scheme. So what we learned is that this proteolysis of NT is really driven by lipid droplet associated proteins. And the way it works, protein kinase A phosphorylates perilipin, then ABHG5 translocates to ATGL, and at this time it activates this proteolytic function, S-lipolysis is actually activated, and it cleaves off this N-terminal fragment that inhibits MEF2, and then a pathway that is driven by NR4L1 is another transcription factor that regulates glucose handling, which results in an accumulation of O-GlucNAC, and this can actually glycosylate calcium handling proteins like STIM1, and that is decisive for inducing cardiac dysfunction. This all can be counteracted by CAM kinase 2, because when it phosphorylates SUG4, it's translocated to a cytosol, and then this pathway is actually unleashed. So we were thinking whether we can restore the cardioprotective state also by a small molecule. So here you see how it looks when everything is good. SUG4 is O-glucanaculated, and NT can be produced, and it can protect from heart failure. When CAM kinase physically bind to SUG4, then it can overcome this state. O-glucanaculation cannot happen, it's very close to the phosphorylation site, and then SUG4 is translocated, and SUG4 NT can also not cleaved anymore. So we had the hypothesis, when we disrupt the binding of CAM kinase to SUG4, that we then can restore the cardioprotective state. It would happen that phosphorylation goes away, O-glucanaculation can happen, and that is the trigger for ABHT5-induced SUG4 NT proteolysis. One big advantage is that CAM kinase has also essential functions that we learned recently. And with this strategy, only CAM4 as a maladaptive target would be inhibited. To gain confidence in that, we developed a mouse model in that we mutated a single amino acid to prevent binding of CAM kinase 2 to CAM4, and we asked whether these mice are protected from heart failure. So this mouse model works. CAM kinase cannot bind anymore to CAM4. It cannot phosphorylate SUG4. This is a very important phosphorylation site. And when we did pressure overload, then you see that the degree of heart failure and fibrosis is not happening when SUG4 cannot bind CAM kinase 2. So we had very much confidence that SUG4 is the maladaptive target of CAMK2. Recent data show that also in a rare form of cardiomyopathy, RBM20, which splices CAM kinase, also shows in CAM kinase overproduction, another splicing variant. It's also very active. You see that phosphorylation of serine 6V2 of SUG4 is increased. This is also happening in a knock-in model for RBM20 cardiomyopathy. These are data from Lars Steinmetz, or a mouse model from Lars Steinmetz at EMBL. These mice develop heart failure. What we decided was to cross these mice to our CAMK2-resistant SUG4 mice, and we found that these mice are protected from RBM20 cardiomyopathy. We will next do it in this model, but this takes a little bit more time. Also, gene expression pathological gene expression was normalized. So this puts us in a position that we have a rare disease that can maybe be used for future clinical studies. So this is a summary of all our proof of concept experiments that we did over the last years. And we compared it actually to loss of function of CAM kinase. So we knocked out CAMK2 delta and gamma in the heart to lose completely CAM kinase and compared it to CAM kinase resistant SUG4 mutant mice. And as you can see, in very, very many cases, CAM kinase deletion is a good thing. But in at least two diseases, we found actually a higher mortality, a higher morbidity. This is an acute stress and also in myosin binding protein C mutations. We also found that these mice have side effects. When we sent them to the German mouse clinic, they develop hypoglycemia, anemia, motoric impairments, all things that we don't want to have. We did exactly the same experiment with the CAMK2-resistant SUG4 mice, and they were actually protected in all cases. And also they didn't show any obvious side effects. So we concluded that as compared to CAM kinase inhibition, disrupting the CAMK2-SUG4 interaction is effective and safe. We did a small molecule screening at EMBL, later a second at the Lead Discovery Center, 500,000 compounds, a protein-protein interaction assay. And I now make a long story very short. This happens now over the last 8 years. And we are now in the phase of hit-to-lead development, to developing compounds that can be given to a mouse model. And that is how one compound looks like. And I'm really excited about it. So you see that serine 6V2 can be induced by phenylephrine in NRVMs, in neonatal red cardiac myocytes. And this compound can nicely reduce the phosphorylation event at SUG4. This compound binds to SUG4 exactly at the pocket where we found the binding domain. And the nice thing is when you look at another very specific TEM-kinase 2 target, which is calcineurin serine 411, it doesn't do anything. So it only prevents the phosphorylation of HTOP4 by KMK2, but not other TEM-kinase 2 targets, exactly what the mouse model predicted. With Wolfram and Malte, we did heart failure in a dish model, EHTs, and here you see that in the first proof of concept that we can also, with a very early compound, we can improve contractile performance in this catecholamine and angiotensin-driven heart failure model. This is now partnered with Novo Nordisk, and they will take over all steps towards clinical application. Then we are able to develop a compound that is really specific and doesn't show toxicity. This remains to be shown. Shortly, I want to talk about HEF-PEF. You know, HEF-PEF is as frequent as HEF-REF, and it is also more common in females. It is driven by systemic disease, by obesity, by arterial hypertension. And the thing is, for HEF-REF, we have many drugs. For HEF-PEF, we had for a long time nothing. Now we have SGLT2 inhibitors, but I think there's also debate whether the mildly reduced patients, the mildly reduced ejection fraction patients benefit, and also there's maybe some concern about side effects. Tim McKinsey has shown that pan-HDAC inhibitors can improve diastolic dysfunction in a rat model, and together with Steve Hauser, he showed in a cat model of HEF-PEF that pan-HDAC inhibitors can help against diastolic dysfunction. So the $1 million question is, what HDAC is actually underlying this protective effect? And as you know, I showed in the first slide, there are many HDACs. And I think the guess is, or my guess was, it must be a class 1 HDAC because these actually have high enzymatic activity. So we asked this question, and we've performed 3 assays, an assay for class 1 HDAC activity, 2A, and 2B activity, and tested that in different mouse models for HEF-PEF. The upper one, high-fat diet and L-name, was developed by Joe Hill. The lower one, high-fat diet and angiotensin in aged female mice by Rudolf de Boer. And I was really surprised not to see any increase of class 1 HDAC activity in these 2 mouse models, but consistently for class 2A. That really surprised me a lot. And also not for class 2B, which is HDAC 6. We confirmed that in a rat model, in ZSF obese model, is a very good model for diastolic dysfunction, the same thing. Then we asked for cardiac biopsies from HEF-REF patients and HEF-PEF patients, and we compared it. And we need a lot of material for class 2B activity, so we couldn't measure that. But again, class 2A HDAC activity was increased, but not class 1 HDAC activity. So we have one class 2A HDAC in our hands, which is HDAC 4. So we tested them, we never did it before. We tested in our conditional HDAC4 knockout mice, HDAC4 missing in cardiac myocytes, and found that in these mice there's already a 50% reduction in class 2A HDAC activity. So we thought this is maybe a good model to test in Joe Hill's HEF-PEF model. And that's what we did. And here you see the development of E2E prime, an echocardiographic marker for diastolic dysfunction. We also did PV loops. We also did all functional assays. And we got a very consistent picture that these mice are protected from HEF-PEF. Not completely, but substantially. Running exercise, this is MPE. This is another marker for echocardiographic marker, but I actually wanted to show running exercise on this slide. Running exercise was also improved in the HDAC4 conditional mice. And the question, of course, is this really due to the enzymatic domain? So we did our homework first, and we found a mutation. We developed a protein with a point mutation in 976, and we made these recombinant proteins, and we measured actually the class 2A activity, and with this point mutation, we were able to reduce the enzymatic activity by 50-fold. This mutation did not affect binding of class 1 HDACs, as you can see here. So we have now a mutation. With that, we can selectively only kill the enzymatic activity, but not MEF2 binding. MEF2 binding is still normal. So we got the mice. So we made knock-in mice for this point mutation, and you see again that these mice have 50% reduction of class 2A extra activity, so it works. And we did again the HEF-PEF model in the same picture. These mice are protected from diastolic dysfunction, and also showed an improved running distance, and they also showed improved markers in PV loops. So this was striking. We then thought we can now go for a pharmacological approach, and we compared Zaha to a class 2A HDAC inhibitor. I cannot say the name, unfortunately, but I will show you the data. And here you see in yellow, we know that Zaha protects from diastolic dysfunction. It does it also in our hands. But the class 2A HDAC inhibitor completely normalized diastolic dysfunction after an early treatment, 1 week after induction of HFpEF with high fat diet and LNAM. So, but it went back to normal levels. And also now, it's, I think, even more interesting, the running distance is almost normalized. So these mice do really better. Also compared to Zaha, the Zaha-treated mice do not very well because there are many toxic effects. We repeated this study 5 weeks after induction of HFpEF. So we gave this class 2 H inhibitor, and we also saw 5 weeks after induction of HFpEF, the Zaha-treated mice died for not cardiac reasons, but they did well, so we cannot analyze the Zaha in these conditions. But here, when diastolic dysfunction was established, we could completely, in a time course of 4 weeks, completely restore diastolic dysfunction. So we have inhibitors against class 2A HDACs, and they protect from HFpEF. And you see again, the running distance is remarkably improved after this treatment. We got insight into the mechanism. We found that high fat diet and LNAM is really leading also to oxidative stress. We found that when we prevent oxidative stress by NAC, that we then can also reduce the induction of HDAC activity. HDAC4 itself is oxidized. So we collaborated then with Milos Filipovic at the ISAS Institute in Dortmund and found that cysteine 700 is sulfonated. And remarkably, so we again did a point mutation in this cysteine and did again recombinant proteins and activated the activity in recombinant proteins with H2O2 that you see in the blue curve. But when you have the mutation, HDAC4 cannot be activated. So there's a cysteine, it's lying in the enzymatic pocket of HDAC4. When that is oxidized, that obviously engages the substrate that we don't know much better. Downstream, we found fibrosis, in particular perivascular fibrosis. So here you see in staining where fibroblast proliferation can be seen in the conditions of high fat diet and LNAM in conditional knockout mice. So when you knock out the HDAC4 in myocytes, you have less fibrosis, pointing to a communication between myocytes and the surrounding. You see that here the fibroblast proliferation is inhibited. We also see that, that endothelial cells get activated by co-staining with alpha SMA, so we have signs for endothelial and fibroblast activation. We did lineage tracing to see whether endothelial cells can undergo endo-MT, but the answer is clearly no. We see that that endothelial cells get activated here by co-staining with alpha SMA, but when we stain for PGFR alpha, we don't see any single cell that becomes a fibroblast. So endothelial cells are activated and probably activate the surrounding fibroblasts to proliferate. And this is my last data slide. If that is right, what I'm saying, then factors should be secreted from myocytes that activate endothelial cells. So we did that experiment. We stimulated cardiomyocytes with palmitate acid and high fat and LNAM, which activates class 2 AHDACs, and then took the conditioned media and put it on endothelial cells, and then you see that endothelial cells can be activated. When the cardiomyocytes are pretreated with a class 2 AHDAC inhibitor, it doesn't happen. So class 2 A inhibitors prevent secretion of factors that induce endothelial activation as probably a cause of fibroblast proliferation. So this was what I wanted to show, and I think what I showed you today is that these data we actually know for a longer time, but we now develop translational approaches to inhibit MEF2 and the non-enzymatic function of HDAC4. But we also now have new data that oxidation-induced activation of HDAC4 induces cardiocrine signaling, as we now call it, which then leads to endothelial cell activation and cardiac stiffening. And for this, inhibitor development is now initiated. Thank you very much. Maybe, yeah.